saw the Everly Brothers on TV. Looks like it sounds good to me. It just sounded great.
And I really wanted a guitar for my 10th birthday. So I was lucky enough to get one.
My brother and I asked their parents if they'd get us guitars, and he changed his mind just before Christmas and got a train set, so I was on my own somewhat.
I used to actually go to the local co-op in the days when I was a kid. That was the big gig. I used to go and watch bands there every week, and I used to watch one position on the fretboard and focus on it and go home and remember where he'd had his fingers on the strings. I kind of learnt like that. Got particularly friendly with two twins who were doing a double act. We were rehearsing one day, and I heard this racket going on, you know, and I thought, cool, I'd like some of that kind of rollover Beethoven type stuff. And I wandered over, and it was this group. And of course it was Francis and the band. And that's how him and I met in 1965.
As soon as Ricky joined, there was something between him and I. He was very showbiz. He had such a tight little bum, you know, and it used to squeak when he walked. It was lovely.
We'd been thinking about a new name, and we were going to call ourselves the Muhammad Ali's or the Queers, because we wanted something people would remember. Our manager at the time, Pat Barlow, he just came down one day and he said, I've seen this name in a shoe, Quo Vadis. No idea what it meant. And we kicked it around, and suddenly kind of Status Quo came out, and yeah, that'll do. And at the end of that rehearsal, we came up out of the cellar as Status Quo. That's really how the real Status Quo, I think, was born.
When Matchstick Men started to get played on the radio, and wow, this is happening.
We'd worked very hard for it, and then all of a sudden, we were reaping the benefits. Through the 70s, we were really happy little things. I mean, it was all coming at us very fast. Gold albums and, you know, chart positions and huge success and topping the bill and tearing the place apart, you know. It was the kind of stuff dreams are made of.
I played quite a lot on the Blue For You album. Then I went to record the whole of Rocking All Over the World album. From that moment on, I was playing sort of full-time.
I've been in Dexter's Midnight Runners, I was wearing the old boiler suits. Straight after that, I did Kim Wilde, looking a bit foppish. I joined Quo, and I mean, I must have looked like some mincing woofter. You know, I can understand why people used to gob at me when I first joined.
I joined in 2000. I just got a call one day from John, the bass player, and he literally said, do you fancy joining Quo? I thought he was joking at first, but no, he was genuine, so obviously the answer had to be yes. It was quite daunting having to join a band that is more or less a British institution.
And the rest, as they say, is history.
Oh,
say they've got the best fans in the world. Well, actually, we have.
We call them the Loyal Family.
Been about 12 times. I've been going since 95. I'll be going to about 6 more gigs this year. Wow. And it's definitely worth it, definitely.
Yeah. No bands play like Quo. No bands rock like Quo. No bands boogies like Quo today. Seeing Quo live today is one hell of a firework. Why don't we break this pattern?
Tell you what, why don't we do some new? They are superb live. Until you see them live, you can't appreciate what a party it is at one of their concerts. I know people always say that they only ever do 3 chords, but I mean, that's a load of rubbish.
If you sell 3 million albums in England, it's roughly 57 million people didn't like it. And I've always found that a real, that's the truth of it, isn't it? You know, because this business does make you feel important. You sit in front of cameras, people talk to you, and so you start to think you're important. But the truth is that most people don't like us. That's just how it is.
Fans are fantastic. They are so dedicated.
You'll go to Australia on the first night opening, wherever you are in Sydney, and there they are. There's a couple of them there. They've flown out to do the Australian tour. And I mean, that's dedication.
Our fans come from all walks of life. You don't know whether you're going to get, right now, what are you doing? Or a burst of, you know, Zen philosophy or something. You know, they're a mixed bag.
Go!
Keep it going, boys, and you're going to get knighted this year.
Oh, yeah, we've seen them quite a few times, actually, yeah.
Not only have they come, they've brought their kids. Their kids have grown up, and now they're bringing their kids, you know. That's real dedication. You have Quo houses, you know, which is literally where the whole music gets passed down. I mean, the guy who drives me, Andrew, he didn't listen to any other band at Status Quo for 8 years. He wouldn't listen to the radio or anything. All he listened to was Status Quo records.
They're happy in what they're doing, and that's what makes it happy for all of us.
The main thing is they all love it.
It's like being with friends, and it's only when you're there that you can pick up on the atmosphere and really appreciate the full quality of the Quo.
You know, they've been with us for a long time, and without sounding cheesy, I can only thank them so much for being there, you know, because the old thing that I know everybody says, but it's true, isn't it? Where would we be without them? Nowhere. So we have them to thank for it, and if they want to arrive scruffy at the gig, let them. Fantastic.
Thank you.
Jim Davidson one night to a kind of a charity auction. And we'd sort of sat and had a few, you know. And this prize came up of a day out on one of Her Majesty's warships. So it got to $3,500, and I thought, well, I'm not going to go anymore. Unfortunately, nobody bid above that. So I got this, because I thought me and my youngest son, he'd like that. What's a
boy do? He went down there for a day with his son, Harry. Said it was fantastic.
And then I went for a drink in the mess with the officers and everybody, you know, and we got chatting about, wouldn't it be great to do a gig up on that flight deck? And they said, well, it could be arranged. And I said, are you serious?
And you had a word with Simon Porter, our manager, and it all came together.
It was 5 months of logistic hell, but we got it on. Played for an hour on the flight deck of the Ark Royal, and it was quite amazing.
It was just fantastic to be able to do something like that. And I was actually thinking about that the other day. It makes all those gigs you used to do for a quid, you know, when you travel 30 stops on the tube or whatever, when you were paying your dues, when you do something like that, you think, well, it was really worth it. So things like that, for me, that make your career something special. Oh, I was sweet on you,
that's how I felt. Now it's almost, if you don't have a video, people can't hear the record anymore. But that's how it is, so that's what we have to do now.
And usually making videos is not good fun.
The making of the video was great fun. As soon as we got there, we were in dressed up in chef's outfits, making jam sandwiches and throwing pots and pans around the galley. And then the next day, we were on the flight deck.
And literally, they gave us the run of the ship.
We had helicopters flying around, and one helicopter banked as it went to fly away and blew my drum kit completely over. I was just left sitting there on my stool with the drums are over there somewhere. To have you, and I need you,
yeah, I need you. Life is hard, I need a remedy. The helicopter pilots, everybody, the Harrier pilots, they've all been so great, you know, taking a helicopter up just to shoot this video of ours. It looks like $1 million, this video. Life is hard, I need a remedy for the way I
feel. My brain keeps landing gem side down. We're really lucky, the weather was fantastic. It was a great experience.
It's a great video for a great song, I think.
Yeah.
Rick is really, really strange guy.
Funniest bloke I've ever met.
He'll say something funny and off we go.
He's very funny.
Nobody plays guitar quite like Rick.
Francis,
he's a very private bloke, Francis.
My pal.
Most loyal bloke I think I've ever met.
And he's my partner.
Enigmatic.
You wouldn't sit next to Francis Rossi quietly for 2.5 hours, no. He loves to chat.
Andrew, I don't know.
Love him to death, you know.
My vegaholic friend.
Wine connoisseur. Rick likes to call me,
I call him my lord.
I think it's little Lord Letley.
Fabulous bloke, got a really nice wife and children.
Matthew is the nicest bloke I don't know.
He's such a gentleman.
He keeps his own counsel, which is very unnerving.
John is a lovely man. He's got a really, really big heart.
John Edwards, he's very keen.
I always call him little brother or John Boy or Clutzy.
He knocks things over.
Clumsy.
He's a great pal as well.
Well, I think we're all a bit weird.
We call it getting our wings, usually.
We did a gig, and there's a certain point where I get up on the drum riser and do a bit with Matt.
Rick jumps on the drum riser to get the tempo of the song, and then he jumps off before he sings.
So I jump down off the riser, merrily make my way to the mic, and I'm going at some pace, and fall flat on my face.
He went flying. Oh, God.
I then struggled, because I thought, I've got to get there to try and sing the intro of the song.
But he tried so desperately to get up in time.
And what I must have looked like.
You can see, oh, yeah, the more we're laughing.
And I mean, you see the front 10 rows of...
Everybody in the front row is wetting themselves laughing.
It's not embarrassing falling over, it's embarrassing getting up. And then you've got to go to the mic and sing, knowing that you've just been flat on your face. Oh, God, it's embarrassing.
If we go out and do a show, we give it everything.
We love playing live.
Where's the work involved in standing up there, doing what you really like doing, people looking at you half the time saying you're great, and then you get paid for it?
If you didn't enjoy being up on that stage, what's the point of being out on the road, you know, because you're not out there for the travelling.
Got a very understanding wife.
Well, how long are we going to go on for?
No one knows.
I don't know.
Rick and I were finishing Rocking All Over the World in the Marquee studio, and we went next door, some punk band were on. I was 27, and a guy about 17 turned around and he said,
"You're off, Rossi, you're pouring off fart."
And ever since then, people have been telling me I'm too old. I find it odd no one goes up to B.B. King and says, "You had enough, B.B.?" He'd just knock you out, wouldn't he? Or, "Why do you only play blues?" That's what I do. Just leave me alone. I'll do this as long as I can.
the baby.